Hello everyone, thank you for joining in. Welcome to another episode of Cancer Talk with Dignite. We have a very special guest joining us today for the interview, for the expert session rather. So we have Dr. Vamshi Krishna joining us. He's a consultant medical oncologist with Apollo Hospitals in Hyderabad. He has passed out of the prestigious Tata Memorial Hospital, where he's pursued his DM, post which in the last 7 years he's been pursuing the his clinical practice. And some of his specialties include lung cancer and molecular diagnostics. And with that, sir, I welcome you for the interview. Thank you so much for your time and joining us today.
Thanks for the interview.
Perfect. So today, the session that we are going to conduct would be specifically focused on metastatic lung cancer. This has been designed by keeping in mind the common questions that patients and caregivers and their family members have during the initial point of diagnosis. So I'm going to ask you those questions. So if you could just highlight them and explain them as if you would explain to patients.
Perfect. Okay. No problem. Okay.
So the first question is, could you please, in simple lay terms, explain what metastatic lung cancer means?
That's a very good question, and it's something which patients often like to know. I often use a very simple tool like this model of the lung. This is a cut section of the lungs. Every person has two lungs, one on the right and one on the left. Typically, a cancer starts when some of these cells in the lung start dividing unnecessarily. These are abnormal cells. They do not do any function. They just keep growing and they are immortal. So they do not die. So you have 1 to 2 to 4. It keeps on increasing in number. It forms a swelling in one place. So that's a small tumor. Soon, what this tumor does is it goes into the blood vessels and it goes into other structures in the middle of the lung, that is the middle of the chest, that's called a mediastinum. And from there into the blood, it goes to the liver, it goes to the lungs, it goes to other lung, it goes to the bones, it goes to the brain. So these cells which are shed in the blood and go to other places to form new cancers there, that is known as a metastasis. So essentially, a metastasis is when a cancer has moved out from its primary origin to a new place, and that is a stage 4 lung cancer.
Okay.
So this staging is artificial. It's something doctors have invented.
Okay.
Essentially to understand that when we say it's a stage 4, it has already gone into the blood and gone to other parts of the body.
Okay.
The idea being, you cannot treat a local area now because the cancer is there in other parts of the body.
Yeah.
You need to give a treatment which will cover the whole body.
Yeah.
That's what a stage 4 cancer is.
Okay. So in terms of the initial symptoms, so if the cancer has metastasized, if lung cancer has metastasized, what are the initial symptoms that the patients get to see?
So lung cancer is a very unfortunate cancer. Even in the West, where they have a lot of programs, where they have more health checkups, 80% of patients even today present in a stage 4 lung cancer.
Okay.
So in India, the number is obviously the same. What happens is, it depends on where the cancer has spread. The commonest symptom that we find is if the patient is having spread in other part of the lung, you can get water in the lung. So that leads to difficulty in breathing. It leads to some pain in the chest wall. It can lead to cough. It can lead to blood in the cough. It can lead to breathing difficulty. So these are the major symptoms that present with cancer in the lung. Rarely we have patients who present with a headache or a brain symptom because of spread to the brain.
Okay.
Or they can present with severe pain in the back or severe pain in bones because of spread to the bones.
Okay.
Again, I have to emphasize, none of these are absolute. Just because you have back pain does not mean you have lung cancer.
True.
However, those are things we need to consider before ruling out a normal situation.
Okay. So, moving on to the next aspect is, what are the types of lung cancer and what are the risks associated with individual types of lung cancer?
When we talk of lung cancer, we describe essentially two types. One is called a small cell lung cancer, and one type is called the all other cancers, which are non-small cell cancer. We are not very imaginative people, doctors. So put small cell and all the others are non-small cell. It is important to know because both these behave in different ways.
Okay.
Small cell is a much more aggressive type of blood lung cancer, which spreads fast and where we do not have a very good treatment available.
Okay.
Now, fortunately, this is only considering around 10% of the total population is small cell lung cancer.
Okay.
The majority are non-small cell. In non-small cell, we have a specific category called an adenocarcinoma, wherein the treatment has really changed over the last 5 years. We are having a lot of oral drugs available, newer medications available, and that is actually increasing in number. So nowadays, that is almost 70-80% of our patients.
Okay.
Whereas previously, it was only 30-40%.
Okay.
The third type is, of course, a squamous cell lung cancer. These are the major types of lung cancer.
Okay.
We are nowadays looking at molecular characteristics. We are looking at mutations in the cancer that decide the treatment for the cancer.
Okay. So, okay, now that we've fairly understood what lung cancer means and what are the types, the common question, the first question that every patient has is, you know, some of them who are non-smokers is, I've never smoked for even for a day in my life. Why is it that I have lung cancer? So for those patients and family members, what do you usually say?
So lung cancer is associated with smoking. Smoking increases the risk of lung cancer more than 20-fold. And the risk persists for more than 10-15 years after stopping cancer. So we have patients who have stopped cancer today. The risk persists for another 10-15 years.
Okay.
Now, among the other patients who do not smoke, other factors could include stuff like environmental pollution.
Yeah.
It could involve other kinds of pollution in the environment, other exposures. Commonest is, of course, increasing age. With increasing age, any cancer incidence increases.
Yeah.
Besides this, if you want an absolute risk factor, we do not really know at this point of time.
Okay.
What we know is that the incidence of smoke cancer is increasing among women, and those women are usually having adenocarcinomas, which are really not associated with smoking again.
Okay.
Now, secondhand smoking is something that is implicated. Passive smoking is being implicated. We do not yet know what about the e-smoking and the vaping, whether they're actually associated with cancer or not. They are associated with lung diseases. We actually had the first death because of vaping recently.
Okay.
So those are things that are coming up. So again, cannot give you a direct answer that this is the reason why you developed, but it's probably a mixture of a lot of reasons.
Okay. Now, moving on to the next aspect, which is the treatment aspect. So in the past couple of years, how has the treatment landscape for lung cancer has changed?
So lung cancer is one success story in cancer. 10 years back, we did not have any medicines for lung cancer, in as much that we hardly used to treat lung cancer.
No.
The only option available was chemotherapy. So the whole scenario changed around 10 years back when we discovered that the adenocarcinomas, around 30-40% of them, have a specific change in their DNA known as a mutation.
Yeah.
Now, this mutation, which was called as EGFR, now that EGFR mutation was very uniquely sensitive to oral tablets, which were called tyrosine kinase inhibitors.
Okay.
Now, these oral tablets could actually control the disease very well for a period of approximately 10-15 months, and there were patients who were doing well beyond that. So, you had patients living for 2-3 years on oral TKIs. This spurred research into newer medications, and now we have a whole bunch of 4 or 5 different mutations which we need to test for before starting any treatment. Now, this includes the EGFR, which I mentioned. It includes another thing known as the ALK and the ROS, the ROS1 and the ALK.
Okay.
We have specific drugs targeted to this.
Okay.
In the last 2 years, what we are seeing is a new medicine known as immunotherapy. The way immunotherapy works is it activates the body's own immune system. Normally, our immune system is there to fight cancers. But lung cancers and other cancers have devised a way to suppress the immune system.
Okay.
Now, we are giving drugs to again make the immune system active and fight the cancer. And the results are quite remarkable. So, we had a first drug, which the results came this year, wherein around 20% of patients on the drug were living more than 4 years after starting the treatment, which is quite a lot for a stage 4 cancer.
Yeah.
So immunotherapy has revolutionized cancer. Now we are looking at combining immunotherapy with other medicines. We are looking at combining different drugs. It's a very exciting field in lung cancer, and we are seeing patients live for substantially more than what they used to.
Okay.
Yes, not all patients can be cured. The cure word is still not something we are using. Having said that, compared to a few months survival 10 years back, it's definitely a much better scene right now.
Okay. So overall, in terms of the treatment landscape, we are moving in the right direction.
Which absolutely. Is absolutely.
Okay. And could you also talk about precision therapies, which are more personalized for individual patients?
So previously, the chemotherapy used to be one size fits all. All patients would get the same chemotherapy.
Okay.
Now we know that a patient whose molecular characteristics are different will require first oral treatment. We may then switch these patients from oral treatment to a different oral treatment based on their molecular results. We may give a different chemotherapy. Some patients benefit with immuno, some do not. And all this is what we need to consider before we plan the therapy upfront for a patient. So the decision making in lung cancer has become much more complicated,
okay.
But it's in the right direction, and we are able to now treat the patient rather than the disease,
okay.
Which is a huge change.
Okay. Common, again, the first questions before getting into any treatment is, how much time does a patient have? And I know there is no straight answer to that question.
Correct.
Ever. So how do you answer that question to the family members?
This is one of the most difficult questions to answer to patients, because everyone would like to know their survival. Unfortunately, we do not have an answer. Largely because, despite the best efforts, different patients may react differently to the same drug. Even though we are talking of personalized therapy, we are trying to look at molecular results, still, the same drug may behave differently in patients. The way I explain is using a rule of 100. So if you have 100 patients, 10 to 20 might do very well. They are at one end of the spectrum. Another 10 to 20 will do badly. They are at the other end of the spectrum. The others would do intermediately. So we do have a median survival. Does not mean everybody will live to that level. Does not mean that they would definitely do badly or definitely do very well.
Yeah.
Again, it's kind of the disease biology that decides the time. And personally, what we encourage patients to do is think of it as time spent valuably. Think of it as good quality of life rather than focus on the exact length of time.
Yeah, I think that's a very good way of looking at life, especially in a metastatic setting.
Yeah.
And amongst few of the questions is predominantly around surgery, right? Because surgery is still considered as one of the most important aspects of cancer treatment. And in metastatic setting, it's not always possible to do surgery.
We do not do normally surgery in a metastatic setting, yes.
So in metastatic lung cancer, when patients are inoperable, does that mean that their treatment prognosis is necessary?
Definitely
bad.
Okay. A person who has a stage 1 or a 2, which is an operable lung cancer, there we have at least 50 to 60% living beyond 5 years. Whereas
okay.
in a stage 4, that number drops to quite low.
Okay.
Despite neurotherapies, it's not more than 10-15% probably. We do not do surgery in a stage 4 because, like I said before, the stage 4 means that the cancer has already spread to other parts.
Okay.
So doing a surgery and removing it is not so simple. And again, when we talk of surgery, it's just one word, but surgery implies removal of a lung. We need to make sure that the person should be able to survive on one lung alone. So it's not such a simple procedure. In the hands of a good surgeon, the morbidity is not so high, but at the same time, it's not as easy as it sounds.
Okay. An early setting where the surgeon has already removed the cancer, but still radiation and chemotherapy is recommended.
Correct.
And why is that? Why is that
done? So the idea goes behind the concept of the cells. Now, when we talk of a cancer, we are talking of a big tissue. Even a 1 gram of tissue will contain more than 1 million cells. Now, these cells are microscopic and they may have already spread to surrounding structures. They may have already spread to outside organs, which we cannot detect because they're microscopic.
Yeah.
Therefore, we use extra treatment trying to kill these microscopic cells, which is radiation and chemotherapy. Therefore, it depends on the type of cancer, it depends on the size of the cancer, it depends on whether the cancer has already spread to surrounding structures. We use these to make an informed guess of whether the patient is going to benefit with extra treatment, and if yes, we give them extra treatment.
Okay.
That is why we often add chemotherapy and radiotherapy to the patients.
Okay. In your past 7+ years of working with cancer patients day in, day out, do you want to maybe highlight one of the examples that has been really inspirational that other patients could learn from?
Well, there's so many patients. All patients, teachers, and they tell us a lot about what human courage is all about, how humans cope with adversity. One of my favorite stories actually is about a young lady, not lung cancer, she had a different kind of a cancer, and she was undergoing chemotherapy. She tolerated it fairly well, she had a good response, and she had a last chemotherapy on 30th of December, and she said, look, I want to come on not this day, can I come 2 days late? So I said, that's fine, but why do you want to come 2 days late? And she said, I want to go to 31st on a party and dance. And for me, that was wonderful. The spirit that she had, and she actually went and celebrated New Year's Day and came happily the next day for doing the last chemo. Okay. And this was 5 years back, and she has subsequently had a child, and the child is doing well. So it's a very inspiring story for me.
Wow. That's amazing. So thank you for that, Doctor. So if you have any questions related to the discussion that we just had, feel free to drop them in the comments below, and we would be able
more
to
than happy to.
So thanks for watching, everyone. Thank you.